Last week, I got into this thing, and it's kind of been my theme all year, that the Jesus came to give us abundant life. Whatever steals that abundant life for us is not from the Father. It's the thief who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. By the way, thieves target treasure, right? So there's treasure in us that may be hidden, may be buried, but it's there. Otherwise, the thief wouldn't bother trying to steal. And Jesus came to give us abundant life. Now, it's very important that we know that God has a life that is so beautiful scripted for us. Before we're born, David wrote this Psalm 139, all my days were written in your book. And it's kind of like God has this book, and it's maybe not literal, although Lou Engle knows people who've gone to heaven and seen the book, you know, and I love Lou, you know, and people see things in dreams, but God communicates with things we can understand. So I'll say it's as if there's a book written. Lou told the story that one page was all written out and the other page was written as we live it. So slowly all the potential disappeared and it was written by what actually occurs. And so the book that God has written for you is somewhat open-ended. Isn't that good? So we don't have to be like the Calvinists who fell down the stairs and said, well, I'm glad I got that over with. Because it's not like God didn't write in there that you were going to have two eggs over easy and some bacon this morning or anything like that. He doesn't write down those things, but he's just writing about you and how, and what the impact that you'll have on his creation as his image and likeness in the midst of creation. And he's writing really your potential. And so all your days are written in his book. Now, of course, he's the great author, and so he has a great plot line. He has a storyline for your life with drama, you know, story arc, and everything. And, you know, no story is a good story if we're not transformed through the trials and struggles that we have to overcome. And isn't that great? Even our tribulations are producing, achieving for us a weight of glory. So God has this great storyline for your life. It's called his thoughts. And all his thoughts toward you are peace. They're shalom. Or I like the NIV. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. They're plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Isn't that good? God did not create you to be a loser, but to be a winner. Now, to be a winner like him. So not by the world's standards, but by his standards. But his plans are that you would have success. They're not for you to be a failure your whole life. Their plans, his thoughts, give you hope and a future. Hope, something to hang on to. A future, something on the other side of the challenges you face today. I love that. All his thoughts are plans. And he knows the thoughts he has toward you. Jesus came. Now, the thief came to steal that from every one of us, steal our identity, steal our potential, destroy the good that we could do. But the wonderful thing is the thief's been caught, and Jesus came to give us abundant life, John 10:10, the second part of the verse. He came, that's his purpose. His whole purpose, the purpose of the incarnation, was to give us an overflowing life, the life that God wrote about in his book before we were born. Now, so how does he do this? Well, there's another statement that he makes about why he came. And this statement is in Matthew's gospel and Mark's. Here's the Mark version of it, Mark 10:45. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. John 10:10, I came that you may have life and have it abundantly. Is it possible that he didn't have two different reasons he came, but this is all the same? That the way we enter into abundant life is not the way of the world, it's the way demonstrated by God. So I came that you may have life and have it abundantly. Is it possible that if we've already been given abundant life, then our mission in this world is to release abundant life wherever we go? that we're actually here not as the problem needing to be fixed, but we're here as the solution needing to express our potential as the children of God, who are called the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Is that possible, that all creation is waiting with eager anticipation for the children of God to get it together and know who they are? That's my version of Romans chapter 8 there. Okay, that so, and how this happens, here's the delivery system. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Is it possible that if we come to serve rather than to be served, that we will actually set people free and that our gift of serving becomes a ransom to release their potential? Oh, now it sounds like responsibility. I just want to wait like Jesus. Farther along, I'll know all about it. Farther along, I'll understand why. But actually, he wants, isn't it something that we could actually be a force in this lifetime that the people we come in contact with experience a release from the bondage they're in? He's in us, right? He calls us the light of the world, you know. So if we're the light of the world, if we could walk into a situation where everyone's in the dark, and because you're there, there's a candle in a cave. People, okay. I know you're thinking like, man, this sounds like a lot of responsibility. Okay. Yay! Lift up your hands and say, these hands are hands of blessing. Everything they touch is improved. Now stand up and let's declare it. I am light in this world. Wherever I go, I bring light. I'm salt. I make things taste better. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. So, this is like the way of the world is we come to be served. Our picture of success is that we give orders and people wait on us, you know. And we ring the bell, tea please, you know, and somewhere these servants come scurrying to give us tea, and wherever we go, people get out of our way. There's a motorcade that goes before us, an angelic motorcade. The glory of the Lord's our rear guard, you know, and we come and we go, and life is easy, just like it was for Jesus, right? Didn't he say, as the Father sent me, so I'm sending you? Oh, okay, might be the same. Now, if Jesus released abundance by coming to serve and not be served, is it possible that we can do the same thing and that the key to our success is not how brilliant we are, but actually how perceptive we are of the needs of the world around us? Oh, well, so we could sum this up. In fact, the title of this message is The Power of Humility. Which sounds like an oxymoron, right? Like, well, wait a minute, humility doesn't have any power. Oh, yeah, but it doesn't have the kind of power this world is looking for, but it has the kind of power that heaven recognizes. So Philippians 2:5, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. In other words, this already belongs to you in Christ. To have this mind, what kind of mind? Well, I did verse 5 in front of verse 3 and 4 because what he's describing is what was in 3 and 4 and then what follows. But let's look at 3, okay? Verse 3. This is Paul's writing to his favorite church, the happy church, the Philippians. And by the way, this is in the ESV, not the NIV, I'll read it off the screen. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. But rather in humility, value others above yourself. Okay? So Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves, is the version that I'm reading. Is it hard to count others more significant than yourself? It's actually supernatural. It's natural and very ordinary that we would, hey, who's the most important person in this room to you? And you could say, you mean other than myself? But the natural is that I am the most important person to me. But that's not the mind that's in Christ Jesus. Verse 4, let each of you look, it's a little easier. Ah, now we've got the right version up here. Okay, let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. This is a little less supernatural. We can still look after our own interests, but then also include others. Hooray. But now I love how Eugene Peterson paraphrases this in The Message, starting with about verse 2. Do me a favor. I just love it. Like, come on, man. Hey, do me a favor, all right? Agree with each other. Love each other. Be deep-spirited friends. Don't push your way to the front. Oh, I told this story in the first service, so I guess I'll tell it this. So, at the beginning, this was the year of divine favor. In the beginning of the year, for some unknown reason, I got the highest elite status from United Airlines, which was a total gift because I didn't actually earn it, global services. What this means is, like, if I go to Washington, D.C., and I land at Terminal A, there might be a Mercedes SUV and somebody with my name on a screen that will drive me to the other thing, because I guess once you fly enough, you're helpless, and they have to drive you to the other terminal. And it's nice. It's called customer relations. But the first time it makes you feel weird, you know? And after that, you're going like, hey, where is it when I really need it, you know? Like, I could have used it this time. They didn't show up. So I think they just use it when they have extra bandwidth, like, hey, when they, you know? But it's a weird thing that you get something the first time, it's like this big surprise, and you're like, oh, God, you're so good. But after about five times, you expect it. Or I'll say I expect it. I know you're much more holy than I am. But so this actually happened to me in August, and I really try. I've met wonderful people on airplanes and ministered to them, and usually I'm a good Christian. But in August, I don't know, I had this, like, sleepless night, and I had this early flight out of LAX, which is not my favorite airport. And so I get there, and I'm kind of shaky because I haven't got enough sleep and all this stuff. And I go, okay, they haven't started loading the plane. And right across from the gate is Klatch Coffee, the best coffee at LAX if you're there, and in Terminal 7. But the I go, I'm going to get a coffee. And then while I'm there, I thought, you know, man, one of these egg burritos, that would just, like, stabilize me. It's a five-hour flight to Washington. Okay. So I get it, and I'm aware that I'm not at my best, you know, so that's why I get the egg burrito. But now I'm waiting, you know, and while I'm waiting, I get my coffee, and I'm wolfing this burrito down with Thanksgiving, so it's sanctified. And I look up, and they're loading the flight. Now, the thing is, when you have this status, they have a special line for you. It's like special class when you were kids. But, you know, and you always get to go on first, no matter what. So somehow, like, it's like, if I don't believe in evolution, but it's like my lizard brain takes over, and I think, like, oh, no, I'm late for my flight. So I rush over, and I find my way not in the regular line, but kind of on the side, and then I just butt my way into the regular line. Not just like Jesus would, right? So, and what's worse is I'm kind of like get in, and I'm a little awkward, and this guy behind me backs up, and he's just relaxed. He must live there. He's wearing shorts and flip flops, and not that everyone in LA dressed like that. And he goes, "Hey, man, you're not that good." Like. Could I just live, could I give mulligan, you know, just like relive the last 5 minutes of my life? Go to the back of the line, it's fine, the chair will still be there when you get on the plane. But, oh no, I'm like, I'm sort of half panicked because I think I've, and man, you just wish you could take it back, don't you? Anybody here? In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, you are absolved of all. So I did. I confessed my sin. But the thing was, I just thought, God, thank you. Okay, you exposed there's a little bit of arrogance and a little bit of, you know, entitlement. And just kill it, Jesus, kill it. So I hope I see that guy again sometime and I'm really nice to him. Because you're thinking like, now, what would Todd White do, you know? You know, I'm like at the opposite end of the spectrum now. Like, okay, put a big J on me for jerk, not Jesus. Okay, what would jerk do? Okay, that's what I did. All right, so do me a favor. Don't push your way up to the front. Don't sweet talk your way to the top, and none of us like that. Put yourself aside. Help others get ahead. Wow, where was that verse when I needed it? I'm preparing myself for next time. Okay, don't be obsessed with getting your own advantage. Anybody besides me ever have that problem? Forget yourself long enough to lend a helping hand. Thank you, Jesus. So, but here's the thing. As illustrated, you know, we're programmed by birth to put ourselves first because I mean, this is really interesting. I mean, just by the fact that you exist and you're conscious of your own existence, which some of you, most of you are, okay, that we actually, we must be aware of our own life. So it's kind of weird, like, well, how can I be focused on myself so that I'm not a jerk, but also, or so I can get my own way, but also be focused on other people? And so it is supernatural. In fact, they did some research. You know, I don't know how they did this. They put little, like, recorders on people. But it was shown that approximately 40% of what people say every day is about themselves. My favorite subject, right? Here I am talking about me up here. Okay, so to gain the gift of another's trust, we must grant them our focus. See, so if I want entrance into somebody else's life, I want to bring abundant life to them, what do? I focus on you. I focus on David Leitch, who's focused on his phone, and so is his father. He must run in the family. Actually, his mother is too. Like, oh, no, they're just putting it on Periscope. This is an awesome message. So, but it's like, but I focus on Rod. He's not, he's just there, man. He's like in the zone. So, but the, good job, Rod. So now everybody puts their phones down like, oh no. So, but when I put my focus on someone else, I'm entering into their world. Isn't that what God does to us? Isn't that, I mean, Peter, do you love me? Peter, who do you say I am? No, I mean, Adam, where are you? That's how God comes to us. It's like he, it's the sensation of being listened to that is like an incarnation of the presence of God. So if I'm listening to you and I put my own agenda aside, isn't it great when you come to Jesus and you tell him whatever you need, whatever you want, whatever you dream, good things and bad things, you usually have this sensation he's listening to you? Have you ever been praying and you felt like God said, hey, could you speed this up a bit? I've got a crisis going on. Did you know about Hurricane Irma? Like, I'm late. No, it's like this amazing presence of unfathomable peace, you know, just peace without end. It's like, oh, I feel so much better now. Thank you, Lord. So if I manifest this, I'm manifesting the very thing that God brings into our lives that sets us free. Salvation is being set free, you know. And so, but the challenge is to do that, to put myself aside, is not natural, it's supernatural. And that my purpose isn't actually for me to be a success, it's to help others get ahead. And that if I focus on that, and I focus on connecting with someone to understand their life and to help them succeed, I'm guaranteed to succeed because give and it'll be given to you. press, you know, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Whatever we sow, we reap. And so, and the amazing thing is that when people sense that you're really focused on them, they open trust to you. And so it's not ordinary that we set ourselves aside, and it's not natural. It's extraordinary. It's supernatural. And here's the thing. You are destined to be a history maker. And the ones who make history are the ones who actually serve, not the ones who demand to be served. Oh, my goodness. Now, you know, and we get, in movies, in our popular culture, the warrior is the great hero. But in real life, the peacemaker will be called the Son of God, the one who brings the solution. And so you could just watch, like, recent movie Wonder Woman. You know, it's all, you know, bad guys are powerful, but the good guys are more powerful. So we just, you know, we just beat them up bad enough, they finally stop, you know. And it's kind of that, you know, it's natural to meet aggression with aggression, especially if you're male, and maybe with some women as well. But we protect our territory. So we respond to aggression against ourselves, against what we steward, against our family, our loved ones. And we feel like, woo! You know, and it's very natural. I grew up in a family with all boys, and we didn't have the light of the gospel. We were without hope and without God in this world. I had four brothers, so, you know, we knew the world of aggression. My older brother would you know, pick on me until I'd get really mad, and then he'd run from me. It's like my aggression overpowered his aggression. At least he didn't want to, like find out who had more rage at the moment. But and we weren't like rageaholics or anything, but so we had this kind of male world, and so we were in this thing where we built, you know, we were into, it's early 1960s, I don't know if I was 11 or 12, but we were into building stilts, you know, so all it took is a couple boards and some wood blocks, and we were getting our stilts higher and higher. And so across, our house was on a hill, and there was a road, and then there was a little forest and a big meadow. And so I was down in the meadow walking around on these stilts, and I was getting so good at it, I was kind of running on the stilts, and I came climbing up the hill with the stilts, and I got up to the road. And this is a resort town, and it's summer. So there's all kinds of people there. We lived near this lake where everybody would go. It was like the place to go. And as I came up, there was a group of boys about my age, maybe a year older or so, walking down the street. They were summer kids. I didn't know who they were. And you know, I guess they were all being tough guys. So this guy goes, "Oh, look at the little sissy on his stilts. Ha, ha, ha." And so I did what I did in my family. I said, "You want to fight about it?" That's just aggression meets aggression. And the kid goes, "Yeah," because he's with his friends. I say, "Okay," so I'm off my stilts, and we're on the side of the road, and we're squaring off, and he's saying, "I'm warning you, I've had boxing lessons. I've had 2 years of boxing lessons," which now as an adult means he was scared and wanted me to back down, but I didn't know that then. I just took it as a strategic information, so I didn't hit him. I tackled him, and down on the road we went, and around, and we're rolling on the road and punching each other. And this was in the 60s where nothing was politically correct. So these people in both directions stopped and are watching, and there's a Jeep full of 20-year-old guys, and they're like cheering us on, like, come on, get him, hit him, oh, don't do that. And it's like, And then the cars further back don't know why everybody stops, so they start honking. And my dad, it was in our house, I don't know why, maybe it was a weekend, and he came down out of the house, down to the street, and sees, oh, it's my darling son in this fight here, you know? So he breaks it up. And these kids are really mouthy, you know, like, "Ah, you big..." Now they're insulting my dad, but he's not even getting mad. I'm like... You know, all kinds of testosterone or whatever was in me. And that's the end of the fight. But here's the thing. You know, when you're 11 or 12, you kind of, it's sort of normal. Although now they have zero tolerance in the school, so I don't know what kids do. They all get neurotic. But the, because they can't get their yayas out, you know. But anyway... So I'm feeling happy, sort of happy that my dad, you know, rescued me from worse things that could have happened. But here's the thing. you know, when you're 12, it's okay. When you're 20 or you're 25 and you're in a restaurant or a bar or something, hopefully you're not in a bar, but some people never grow out of this, you know, and you see you have grown men getting in big fights and or how about road rage, which is even more dangerous, right? You know, you're driving along and somebody, because you're a perfect driver, but they, for some reason they're aggressive and they just, for no reason, give you the Hawaiian love sign and inside you, you're like, you know, and people die because they don't know how to, like, just like, here's what's really well. Even if you're not guilty, you could say, sorry. Even though I wasn't a sissy on the stilts, I could go, oh, too bad. You know, but it's like, this is the mind of Christ. Not that we defend ourselves, but that we make a way. Well, that, but then if you say you're sorry and you didn't do anything, it makes you seem like you're guilty. Yep. Just like Jesus on the cross, huh? Let this mind be in me that was also in Christ Jesus. Like, oh, hey, sorry, man. Isn't it better to stop a fight than to win a fight? Okay, just asking. And smile and a wave. It's like humility, absolutely. It's counterintuitive, but it's more powerful than aggression. And so bullies are overthrown, liars are exposed, gamblers lose, manipulators make mistakes. But those they that wait upon the Lord will inherit the earth, Psalm 37. And they'll also renew their strength, Isaiah 40. You guys know your Bible verses, okay? But it's like the meek will inherit the earth. And the meek rhymes with squeak, makes me think of a mouse. Meek doesn't mean you're a little afraid person. Meek is actually, it's a special word when Jesus says, blessed are the meek, they shall inherit the earth. The meek means strength under control. Stand down, soldier. You know, like, do not pull that trigger. Ah, that's meek. Meek, it was a special word used to describe a well-trained war horse. And if you imagine, it's funny, like war and meek doesn't sound right, but actually the only horse you would want to ride into a battle would be a meek horse, which meant it wasn't reacting out of its own feelings if somebody sliced it with a sword or a spear hit it, but it was responding only to the master. Wouldn't it be awesome if all of us, we only responded to the master? Oh, then I wouldn't have cut in line and been a jerk, you know? And, oh, my God. Meekness is strength under control, and it's a fruit of the Spirit that brings us to that place where we govern ourselves. And one of the things we do to govern ourselves is we just settle that God has a great plan for us and that we don't have to take care of ourselves. He will take care of us. And that I'm going to actually achieve my destiny by helping others achieve their destiny, by helping others achieve their goal. And that I don't have to worry about whether people like me. If they can tell I like them, they'll probably like me in return. Like, have you ever... Okay. It's so human, but it's just, and sometimes, I mean, we to take the lower road sometimes means even if we have the solution, even if we know, like, what your problem is, that people aren't ready to hear that until they know that I've slowed my process down and I want to know their heart. With that, that's the introduction to an awesome video, I hope. Well, maybe the same. Oh!
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me. And I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head. And it's relentless. And I don't know. don't know if it's going to stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever going to stop.
You do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there...
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen.
See, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out. See, you're not listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just... Sometimes it's like there's this achy... I don't know what it is. And I'm sleeping really well. And all the sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
That sounds really hard.
Yes. Thank you. Ow!
Come on, if you would just...
Don't!
Help us, Jesus. Like, isn't it like counterintuitive to not use our knowledge to fix it, especially if you're a man. Maybe with women you're more intuitive, but help us, Lord, to set aside what we know and to hear the issue of the heart. Wouldn't it have been great if when she said thank you, he just got like, oh, this is working. But anyway, life isn't like that. So, what actually happens when we slow down and we posture ourselves to serve, we're actually entering into love. The way we treat others is the way we treat God. As you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. And... Sorry, I mean, not like God has a nail in his forehead and he needs us to fix him at all, but it's like when we open the door, we are hardwired for love because we were created in the image and likeness of love. And when I can receive someone and it's obvious I'm enjoying it, I am giving them my life as a ransom. I'm giving them my knowledge. I'm giving them my time. It's a ransom, and it sets them free and lets them come out. Oh, my goodness. Anyway, and if I'm in love, there's infinite possibilities because whoever lives in love lives in God, and God lives in him or her, and with God, nothing is impossible. So if I want to change the world, my goal is how can I serve? How can I listen? How can I establish trust? And there's kind of a description here. You've probably heard this before. 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient and kind. Doesn't envy or boast, is not arrogant or rude. Doesn't insist on its own way. Man. That's the tough one. It's not irritable or resentful. Help us, Lord. So why don't you stand up? I just want to, I just believe that God is going to give us an upgrade of entering into love, that our delay is over, that there are, that if we posture ourselves to serve, we will discover that there is favor and influence and open doors like we've never seen. And sometimes we think the breaker anointing is some kind of intense force and power, but I want to tell you, the breaker anointing might just be, I'm here to serve. How can I help? And that the most supernatural thing we can do is actually love someone, begin to understand their dreams, perceive their callings, and position ourselves to help them live the life that God has planned for them, plans that they would prosper and not fail. It's just kind of this amazing thought. So lay your hands on your brain. Now, you know, humans, of all the creatures God made, we're the only ones with a significant forebrain. There's this part of our brain that can reason, that can see, that can perceive things that are not evident there in front of us. And I think God uses that in our brain and gives us pictures called words of knowledge. It's a gift from God. Holy Spirit, would you come upon us and activate this mind that is ours in Christ Jesus, that doesn't need to exploit position and doesn't need to go after who's the most aggressive, who's the most powerful, but has the power to release the new creation. All creation is waiting for this. Would you clothe us this week in love? Would you make us those unbreakable optimists, filled with peace, with a deep, deep peace and a security that we are loved, that as dearly loved children, we would imitate God. And we would give, we would walk in love, giving our lives as a ransom, as a gift for others. Man, I feel the power of God here. It's like, wow, I think this is like a breakthrough. This is part of the breakthrough. Oh, God, just activate us. Give us a sensitive conscience when that me, 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 that insecure part comes up, that's the thief trying to steal the power. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, I would like, if the ministry team would get, yeah, come on, God is good, isn't he? By his great and precious promises, we participate in his divine nature. Oh, my goodness. And that allows us to escape the corruption that's in the world through selfish interests, through sinful, through lust, through wanting the wrong things, or wanting the right things in the wrong way. Everybody, okay, you guys, here's the deal. These guys are so anointed. Yeah, we're going to get some over here because you guys need help too. These are really anointed people. If you feel like, man, I need some breakthrough, I need some help, you're welcome to come up and they'll pray for you. There's grace here. You need healing. Anything you need prayer for, they're here for you. The rest of you, may the Lord bless you. May his divine favor and protection be on you. May he keep you. May his presence shine on you. And may you bear his name and his nature wherever you go. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great week.